Hello there, I'm Peter Zeidman. It's a great pleasure to be with you today. And if you're watching this as part of the SPM for MEG course, I've got the honour, the privilege of having the last lecture of the day. And what I'm going to try and do is summarise everything you've heard so far in terms of DCM and modelling and try and put it into a recipe that you could apply for your own MEG studies. I'm going to try and express this in terms of seven steps to DCM success. The first step is to write down some hypotheses, and we'll talk about the kind of hypotheses that you can test using these methods. You then have to design a suitable experiment, and all the principles of good experimental design apply. Then there's data collection and pre-processing, followed by first level or within subject DCM analysis, and we'll talk about the different options you have at those two stages. Then we can take our connectivity parameters up to the group level and ask what's similar and different between subjects. That's using a technique called PEP, or parametric empirical Bayes, and we'll talk about how that works. Then probably the most important step of all is Bayesian model comparison, which means assigning evidence to our different hypotheses and picking the most plausible of them. And we'll talk about how to do that. There's also an additional optional step that you might want to take, including your study, which is to ask, now I've got my best possible model for these data that I could find, is that model useful? Can it predict some quantity I've left out, some clinical or behavioral measure? And that's called assessing predictive validity. Of course, there's some extra steps after you've done all this good science. You have to write the paper and potentially win your Nobel Prize. And unfortunately, there tends to be a bit of a gap between stages 7, 8, and 9. Nevertheless, I'm going to try and walk you through stages 1 to 7 and make sure you're best equipped potentially to get to point number 9. Before I get started on this recipe, I just want to talk about maybe the one key take-home message from all of the DCM talks and the whole course, actually, is the importance of a generative model and the philosophy that we're trying to explain the causes of data rather than just describing data features. And just to use a slightly silly example, think of waves that occur not from the brain, but in terms of music and being created by musical instruments. Let's say you had two different instruments. One is a priceless Stradivarius, and one is a cheap factory-made modern violin. And your question, your scientific question, is why do people feel that the sound of a Stradivarius is so much better? How would you assess why these two instruments sound different? Well, one option is you could look at the data that they generate. So you can look at the sound waves, and you could try and measure those sound waves from each instrument in a particular way. You could look at the wavelength, you could look at the frequency, you could look at the amplitude, and you could write a very nice paper showing how these different data features are different between the two violins. But at the end of that, you'd have absolutely no idea why one instrument sounded better than another. So that's a data features or a description kind of approach. To answer the question, we have to go deeper into the mechanisms of how the music was generated or the sound was generated. And for that, we need a model. And a model here would be putting together absolutely everything that is known about how violins generate data. So for example, you could specify a model that would allow you to try changing the materials and the qualities of different parts of the instrument, do little virtual experiments with your simulated instrument and see how it affects the predicted data. And then you can compare that to your real data and see what differs between the two instruments, not in terms of the observed data, but in terms of the underlying parameters of the instrument, the underlying mechanisms. And that process of going from the data to the underlying mechanisms is called model inversion. And the DCM recipe I'm going to be walking you through today includes both specifying models that can predict data and then running them in reverse, so-called model inversion, to ask about the underlying causes of those data. Statistically, that question of which hypothesis or which model best explains my data has a really specific formulation. And it uses a quantity in the world of Bayesian statistics anyway. It uses a quantity called the model evidence. This is really the key statistic for our modeling endeavors. You would have heard a bit about this on the Bayesian lecture earlier. It's the probability of having observed my data given a particular model, model one. And having just one model isn't useful. You really need at least two models. And then you can express the relative evidence of the two models by writing them like this as a ratio. And that likelihood ratio, when we're working in a Bayesian world, is called the Bayes factor. So if this ratio gives you a number that's much bigger than one, then it shows you that the top model, model one, is much better than model two. Whereas if you had a value much smaller than one, it tells you that model two is better. How do we use that in practice? Well, what we do is we take each of our hypotheses, we express each hypothesis as a model with a corresponding equation. So we've got equations under each one here. We then follow a procedure to estimate this quantity, the model evidence, for each model. And then we can express the ratio. And let's say that the model one here was five times better than model two, this likelihood ratio was 5 to 1, then we could be really confident that model one was a better explanation. In fact, in science, we like to, the general practice is to go for at least 20 to 1 evidence before we'll say something is strong evidence for one model relative to another. Right, so back to our 7 steps to DCM success. Step one, write down some hypotheses. Now, what do hypotheses look like in this context? It's important to say that DCM is a tool for scoring the evidence for different hypotheses, and it's not an exploratory technique. So you need to be able to say, what are the different models that I want to use this machinery to assess? Those hypotheses could pertain to the commonalities across your participants. For example, I hypothesize that top-down connections from parietal cortex are modulated by paying attention to visual stimuli. Yep, that's a really clear hypothesis. Or your hypothesis might come down to the differences between people. I hypothesize that people with a diagnosis of mild cognitive impairment have weaker modulation of top-down connections by attention. So think about commonalities and differences and hypotheses for each. And typically in a group study, you would have hypotheses about both what's typical and what's different. Now, we need to talk about the relationship between a hypothesis, which you might state before you do your experiment, and a model, which is how you're going to take that hypothesis and make it formal, make it expressed in a really specific way. And that's what DCM lets you do. A common thing to do is to have one hypothesis corresponding to one model. So here we've got 4 different models, each is a hypothesis, and they differ in terms of which connections, shown here in red, are modulated by some experimental manipulation, the dorsal, the ventral, the left, or the right. It's one hypothesis corresponding to one model, and then you'll assign the probability for the data given all 4 of these, and you can compute your Bayes factors. The other thing you can do is have one hypothesis correspond to a family of models. Family of models, a family is just a group. And here we've got 2 families or 2 groups of models, and all the models in one family share some common feature. So it could be, for example, that, and this isn't such a clear example, but it could be, for example, that one family of models has all your dorsal connections, top down, dorsal to ventral, and family 2 contains models where there are ventral to dorsal connections. So now, rather than one model being equal to one hypothesis, you've now got a whole group of models that correspond to one hypothesis, and that's called a family. And whereas before we were assessing the evidence per model, now we can assess the evidence per family. Either way, you have to think about the working memory capacity of the reader of your paper. They can only store so many hypotheses when reading your study. So that inevitably means you either need a few models or a few families of models, but not too many. I also find, for DCM analysis particularly, drawing diagrams for each hypothesis can help. So here I've got different connectivity architectures. I'm drawing each network as using circles for the brain regions, and then drawing connections between those regions. And each one is a hypothesis. And that's, I find, is a very useful tool. And then when I get to the end, I write my results onto that same diagram so I can then understand what the model was revealing. All right, so that was hypotheses. Now you've written down those hypotheses. Now it's time to design an experiment. And there aren't too many specific requirements for EEG analysis. Certainly you don't have all the restraints that fMRI brings about. One piece of advice I'd give is just to use a factorial design where possible. And a factorial design directly maps onto how a DCM gets set up. So consider this example 2x2 factorial design. Factor one is whether faces are displayed either in the normal position or if they're upside down. And the second factor is whether the subject, the participant, was cued to attend to the emotion of the face or to attend to the hair color, which would be like a control condition. And this experiment, we're interested in understanding the effect of emotional faces on the brain. And we hypothesize that there might be an interaction, that parts of the brain will care about emotion only when the face is the right way up, not when it's upside down. So that's an example of an interaction between two factors. So that maps neatly onto a dynamic causal model. So let's say we've got two brain regions that we're modeling, primary visual cortex, V1, and the fusiform face area. You could then have a modulatory effect. In other words, you'll see this in software described as a between conditions effect or a between trial effect for each of the different experimental manipulations. So a between trials effect for the main effect of faces. So we're hypothesizing here that this connection gets stronger or weaker depending on whether there's a face. You can include a second modulator for the main effect of emotion. So does this connection get strengthened or weakened by the presence of an emotional face? And you could also include the interaction in the model. And my only caution there is interactions do get a little bit hard to interpret when they're included in a DCM, because this is, in a sense, already an interaction between V1 and FFA. So my general advice would actually be to have one of your main effects modulate one brain region or a connection, have your other main effect modulate a different brain region, and then let the interaction emerge through the interaction of those two brain regions through their connectivity. So in general, I would use modulatory inputs in the DCM to model the main effects. I probably would not include the interaction explicitly. I'd let that emerge naturally through the connectivity. Right, we've written down hypotheses, we've designed an experiment, now it's time to do our data collection and pre-processing. Now, you've had talks on all these different pre-processing steps. There's nothing really specific to DCM. It's just the case that depending on which DCM you're going to do, you're going to pre-process the data in different ways. I want to highlight a particular pair of options that you can choose between. One option is to treat the DCM as a model of the entire brain, of everything that's going on in the brain during your experiment. So what you do is you have at the neural level, you'll have some neural mass model, And then the model has a lead as a projection to the cortical surface, what's called a lead field. And now you have a complete generative model of the brain. And what you'll see here, the data will, the data that this model predicts is the whole brain activity. In fact, it will do a principal components analysis automatically and reduce all of your data down to just the first 8 principal components. And the DCM will try to explain those 8 principal components. The advantage of that is you've actually tried to model all the data you've observed. It's very elegant. A limitation of that is that we typically just have a few sources in a DCM, and we pick those ones that are modulated by our particular experimental conditions, or that we hypothesize will be. But there may be many other generators in the brain that contribute to the electromagnetic activity. So this may not be a very good model of the entire scalp if those brain regions you've included in your DCM are not comprehensive. There's other brain regions getting involved as well. So another approach you might want to do is firstly extract time series from different parts of the brain using a simpler source localization approach. And you had lectures earlier on source localization. Extract time series from each of the brain regions of interest, and then apply DCM to model the interactions between those extracted time series. So you may hear of a phrase like virtual electrodes. What that means is we use a simple source localization approach to find out where the key sources in the brain are, and then use that model to allow us to extract some particular time series where we've controlled for all of the other sources in the brain. And now just apply DCM to those few sources. And unless you have a very tightly controlled experiment where only a very small number of brain regions are modulated by your task, I think this approach on the right generally makes sense. Right. First level DCM analysis. So you've got your data ready. You're now ready to start modeling it. You've got a whole zoo of different models you can choose from, and you've heard a lot about these in the previous talks. So just to recap the main categories, you've got models that are either physiological or phenomenological. Physiological means they reproduce or recapitulate the underlying physiology. They in some way, to a greater extent or lesser extent, look like a brain network. And you've got a few different options here. Phenomenological models, by contrast, don't look like brain networks, but they can still generate data features that look like EEG or MEG activity. For example, oscillators and having coupled oscillators, which you can get through these methods, through the phase coupling model, for example. And if you want to read more about the precise details, there's a wiki page that just gives a summary of each model. Within the physiological models, you've got convolution and conductance models. The convolution ones are simpler, they're easier to fit, they behave a little bit better, and that's a good starting point. The conductance models let you go deeper into particular synapses or particular receptor types. They are a little bit more tricky to work with, they're a bit more fiddly, but can be useful particularly for much more specific pharmacological questions. So if you're just getting started, I recommend starting with the simplest model you can. DCM for ERP is a very simple model for modeling EEG, MEG data, or DCM for LFPs. Start from there, or if you particularly need to look at predictive coding and you need to separate ascending and descending streams of activity in the brain, you might start with a slightly more complicated model, which is the canonical microcircuit. Once you get used to those, move on to the more sophisticated conductance models. The exact model you use will depend on the data features you need and the parameters that you want included in the model. And again, have a look at this Wikipedia page, which talks about each topic. So you'll be choosing your model based on the type of data you've got, the model features you need, and ultimately, if you're unsure which kind of model to use, fit more than one, and then use Bayesian model comparison to assess which is the best model of the data. And we'll come to that a little bit. I want to recap what you get as your output from your first level DCM analysis. So you get two outputs. The first one is this really useful number called the free energy. It originally comes from statistical physics, was then refined in machine learning and also in neuroimaging. The free energy is an approximation of the log model evidence. So the model evidence is the probability that I would have seen these data given my model. In practice, we tend to work with the log of the model evidence because it makes the mathematics a lot easier. The free energy is an approximation, or to be really precise, a lower bound on that log evidence. It's really useful because it's one number that just scores how good the model is. And I'll come back to why that is the case shortly. The other outputs you get are the estimated parameters. And what DCM, being a Bayesian method or probabilistic method, you get not just the strength of each connection in your model. You also get, you actually get a probability distribution over the connections, over the parameters, which means you're not just being told the connection strength, but also the confidence or uncertainty about those connection strengths. More formally, what you get is a multivariate Gaussian distribution, which is the posterior probability of having seen the parameters given the data and the model. Let's say, this is how I visualize this. Let's say you've just got two parameters in your model, parameter one and parameter two. DCM will give you this mountain here. The peak of that mountain is what the estimated connection strengths are. So a value here of about zero for parameter one, and maybe, it's a bit hard to see here, but maybe about minus one for parameter two. But that's not the only important thing. The other important thing is the width of this mountain in each axis. That's the variance or the uncertainty. So the more spread out that distribution in a particular direction, the less confident we can be about the value of that parameter. So what you'll actually get is the connection strengths expected values, and you'll get the variance, and you'll also get the covariance among these parameters, which controls the rotation of that mountain. So that's everything you get out at the first level: the free energy score, how good is my model, and then the parameters that were selected that made that free energy as good as possible. Got a little demo here that just shows the algorithm that we use for fitting models. Due to time, I'm not actually going to go through this example now, but if you want to go through it in your own time, you can. And it just shows how a simple dynamical system can be fitted to data using SPM. And there's the mathematics is shown on the left, and the corresponding code is shown right. So one message I really want to get across is, after you've done your first level DCM analysis, it's not enough just to compare models and say one is better than the other, Bayesian model comparison. You also need to check that a non-trivial amount of variance has been explained. You could have one model that's 100 times better than another model, but both models are rubbish. You need to be careful about that. So the way to do that is just to look at the variance explained, or the model fit. And you can't use these kind of model fit characteristics to say if one model's better than another, but you can use it just as a sanity check to make sure that nothing's gone wrong, essentially. And I'm showing that here with plots that come from SPM in the time domain or in the time frequency domain. Okay, so we've done our first level analysis, having collected our data, and we've now checked that our models are fitting well by looking at the explained variance. It's now time to move to group analysis and what's called parametric empirical Bayes, or PEB. The kind of questions you might want to ask in a group study look like this. For a start, are there any particular connections where the strength of that connection has been changed by an experimental manipulation? Does belonging to a diagnostic group determine the strength of particular connections? Can we see a difference between patients and controls, or people under different drug manipulations? Does the strength of particular connections correlate with some behavioral or clinical variables that I've withheld and that I now want to use to assess predictive validity? So all of these questions are facilitated using a framework in SPM called parametric empirical Bayes. And what it does is that it extends the within subject models that we've been looking at so far to being a model of both within and between subjects' effects. Oh, and I should just mention this last point here about prediction. Could I predict a diagnosis or a behavioral score using our estimates of the connections? So let's just walk through what we mean then by empirical Bayes. It's a standard approach in Bayesian statistics, but within SPM, we have our own particular flavor that brings a certain number of advantages. So let's say this is our DCM for a particular subject, subject I. And this is a really generic way of writing a DCM. This is what's called a state space model. The rate of change of some latent variables, X, or state variables that we can't observe with respect to time is given by the model. So the latent variables here would be the voltages and the conductances of different neural populations or different synapses. F is my DCM, and it's a function of the current latent variables, some experimental inputs, and the parameters, for example, the connection strengths, theta. My observed data is then a function, G, of the latent variables, those voltages and conductances, plus some error. And G here would, for example, be the lead field that translates from the neural to the scalp activity. So we've got the rate of change of neural activity X at time T, got the neural model, the MEG data is Y, and the observation model is G. And I've underlined theta here because that's the really interesting thing we want to infer. Those are the connection strengths, for example. What PEP does is it now adds a second level to the model. And it's if we just take these parameters, theta, from all the subjects, and we're going to like arrange them in one long vector. We'll call that theta. So it's the parameters from each subject, subject one to n. And we'll model that using a general linear model with a design matrix X, some parameters beta, and now errors at the second level. And these errors here is what's called the random effects or the between subject variability. So what we've done now is we've extended the model to within and between subject effects. For any given one given subject, we're treating their parameters as having been sampled from the group level parameters that we get here on the right. So the connectivity parameters are taken to the group level and then modeled using a general linear model. This is showing what I've just showed you, and this is just a graphical illustration. So if, for example, we only had one connection in each subject, so I've got my six subjects here, I might model their between subject effects at the second level using a design matrix, so it's a general linear model. So each column in the design matrix is a hypothesis about what I think is common or different among my subjects. The first column is a constant, it's a column of ones, so that is going to model the group average of this connection. The second column might be a group difference, minus ones and ones, to encode whether the subject is a patient or a control. And the third one may be a continuous regressor, maybe age, for example. The DCM PEB parametric empirical Bayes framework is going to estimate this complete hierarchical model, the within subjects and the second level effects, the group effects. And it's going to provide you with two outputs. It's going to give you the free energy for the entire group level model. So remember, the free energy is a score for how good your model is. What you get now is a free energy, just a single number, that tells you how good your complete group analysis is. And that's really useful because it means you could try different within subject models. So you could try different DCMs, or you could try different between subject models. So you could try different design matrices here with different regressors in and see which of these different mixtures can best explain all of your group level data. So that's why this free energy score is so powerful. It's one statistic that lets you score the quality of all of your analysis. The other output you get is an estimate of the group level parameters. So this is the theta two here. It's the weight for each of your covariates. So you will, for example, get the effect of being patient versus control on each connection. And you'll get the effect of the effect of age on each connection and the group average of each connection. And I've just shown the simple example here where we've only taken one parameter, one connection from each subject. In reality, this is a much longer vector because we have multiple connections per subject. And so in this design matrix, what you'll actually get from the software is the effect of all three of these regressors on each of the connections. Right, so that's second level analysis called parametric empirical Bayes. We've nearly finished now. We're now going to do Bayesian model comparison to assess the evidence for our hypotheses, those hypotheses we first set out in stage one. Let's say we've got two different PEB models. The first model, we've got three covariates. And in the second model, we've removed the effect of age. In fact, what we would usually do is not remove a covariate, but we would fix the corresponding parameter, the beta, to zero by setting a really tight prior. But that's a technical detail. You can think of this as effectively we're switching off the effect of age. We can then fit those two models to the data, get a free energy for each one, and then compute. Do you remember the log Bayes factor that I introduced much earlier? It was the ratio of model evidences. And because the free energy is the log evidence, when you're taking logs, a division, a ratio, becomes a subtraction. So the log of the Bayes factor is simply the difference in the free energies. That's how much better is the free energy for model one compared to the free energy for model two. And then that difference in free energy tells you which was the better explanation, and therefore, was there an effect of age? And it's straightforward then to convert that actually into a probability for with age and without age that you can report in your paper. So that's how we practically test hypotheses using PEB. Another technical detail that you'll see a lot in papers, it's quite important, is that we don't need to separately assess the evidence for each of the two PEB models. Instead, we can just fit the one that's got all the parameters of interest. We usually refer to that as a full model. And then we can use an analytic technique to derive the free energy of the reduced model. And that analytic technique is called Bayesian model reduction. There's a few advantages of that. And one of the advantages is that it's almost instant. So you're able to score the evidence for potentially thousands of different combinations of turning on and off covariates in just a few seconds at most using Bayesian model reduction. Okay. I mentioned in passing that we can easily go from the log of a Bayes factor, in other words, the difference in free energies, to a probability. And in fact, probabilities are much easier to report in your paper because a probability, you know, everyone knows a probability goes from zero to one. So you can say there's a 90% probability for an effect of age. I won't go through this now, but it turns out there's a really simple equivalence between the log Bayes factor and the probability that one model is better than another. It turns out it's a sigmoidal function, also called a softmax function. And you can simply plug in your log Bayes factor and get the associated probability under, and this is important, under equal priors for the two models. So by using this approach, you're saying a priori, I'm going to treat these two models as equally likely. And then if I'm willing to commit to that, then there's a simple transform that takes me from the log Bayes factor to posterior probability. And that makes it simpler for your readers. I just want to talk about as well, we've heard a lot about this log evidence thing, this free energy thing. I think it's just worth mentioning why we use it in principle. And this is, I think, really important, and it speaks to some really general principles in science that go beyond DCM, goes beyond EEG or MEG. The question is, what makes a good model? And from a statistical point of view, a good model provides a trade-off between accuracy and complexity. You want a model to be really accurate. You want it to explain your data, but you want it to do it as simply as possible with fewest parameters in play. Different approximations of the model evidence quantify complexity in different ways. And these aren't exactly both approximations of the evidence, but close enough. AIC and BIC, you'll see a lot of statistical software packages will provide these approximations, and they quantify the complexity of a model in terms of the number of parameters P and the number of data points N. The free energy also is accuracy minus complexity, but it has a different way of computing the complexity. The complexity in DCM is how far have the parameters moved from the prior probability to get to the posterior. So how much have we learned about the parameters from doing the experiment? It's a continuous measure. This function here is called the KL divergence. It's a measure of distance between two probability distributions. The reason why the free energy complexity measure is much better and much more reliable than the AIC or BIC is because in practice, with real data modeling, there will typically be covariance between your parameters. So although you've got P parameters in your model, it's highly likely that some of those parameters will do something very similar to the data as other parameters. Turning up one parameter has a similar effect as turning down another one, for example. That's called covariance among parameters. That covariance is ignored by AIC and BIC, and as a result, you can get really weird results. The free energy takes the covariance into account through this thing called the KL divergence, and therefore it behaves much better. And if you want to see numerical simulations related to that, see this paper by Will Penny. There's a really detailed, like we can go quite deep actually into why we use the model evidence. That's one reason that I've just mentioned, that it quantifies the complexity better. There's a couple of others. I just want to mention this one, which is really important, Occam's razor. So you'll be familiar with Occam's razor. It's the idea that the simplest possible model is generally the best. And if you choose between models based on the log evidence, you're naturally selecting the one that's going to give you that optimal trade-off between being accurate and being simple. And you can demonstrate that mathematically. This is Bayes' rule, which you heard about in the Bayes lecture earlier. If you take Bayes' rule and you rearrange the terms and take some expectations, you can show that the log model evidence, that's this key quantity that we approximate using the free energy, can be decomposed into two terms, accuracy minus complexity, that I showed you on the previous slide. So naturally, the best model of the data, the one that maximizes the free energy, so and the log evidence itself, has to either be the one that's more accurate, or it has to be less complex, or both. So you get that for free when comparing models based on the log evidence. I'm going to skip Jane's principle just in the interest of time. I'll just mention the Neyman-Pearson lemma. This says that if you've got two potential tests, a test based on a likelihood ratio, like a t-test or an f-test or a chi-squared test, is the most powerful test that you could do for any given effect size. That's true in classical statistics, but you can also extend that, generalize that to Bayesian statistics. And because the Bayes factor is an example of a likelihood ratio or an evidence ratio, you can show that the Bayes factor is the most sensitive test for a given effect size. Underscoring again why we use it, there's no test you could develop that would be more powerful. I've mentioned just in passing earlier this concept of Bayesian model reduction. It's a really powerful technique that we use that means it's really fast in the software to evaluate, to score the evidence for potentially thousands of different models. You've got two different ways you can use this in the software. Either you can specify your hypothesis-driven models, that differ in terms of which connections are in play or which modulatory inputs typically in a DCM are in play. So which connections differ between your experimental conditions. Model one will be a full model with all potential connections of interest in play. And then your other models will be reduced versions of this that you hypothesize. And what the software will do in just a few milliseconds is, having estimated the full model evidence, it can compute the evidence for the other models using this analytic approach called Bayesian model reduction. That's really nice because it's hypothesis driven. In the special case where all possible reduced models are equally likely a priori, you're licensed to use another approach, which is an automatic search. And an automatic search will go through and try thousands of different mixtures of switching on and off parameters to find the best explanation for your data. This has been described as structure learning in neural networks. And if you want to read more about these approaches and how they work and a worked example that you're seeing here with DCMs of different structures, then there's a preprint that I'd recommend reading. Right, and now we're down to the final step. We've done our model comparison. We've identified the best explanation for these data, which maximizes the accuracy, that minimizes the complexity. And now we're on to assessing predictive validity. Is my model actually useful? So here's the question. Question is, are the effect sizes that I detected large enough to predict the group membership or clinical scores of new participants? The approach that we take in SPM is leave one out cross-validation. And you'll get a plot that looks something like this. What it's going to do is it's going to build a PEB model, a general linear model, fitted to all the subjects except for one who's left out. It's then going to try and predict a covariate that's been included in the design matrix for the training data set. And it's going to see if it can guess or predict that value for the left out subject. It then iterates, leaving out each subject in turn and then averaging over the subjects. And what you'll get is a plot that looks like this. It's called the out of samples correlation. It's the correlation between the value in the design matrix that was really there and what was predicted for left out subjects. And for this example data set, you can see that the real group effect is along the bottom here. The estimated beta regression coefficient is here. And you can see there's a really clear difference between the two, except for one outlier subject who's been assigned to the wrong group. It's highly, highly significant. And typically people would look at P of 0.05 or less here. So notice we've switched back now from Bayesian to classical statistics, just because that's what's more commonly reported in the literature. So what this approach allows you to do, just to recap, is not to test a hypothesis. To do that, you should use Bayesian model comparison. And we've seen that because there's something called the Nyman-Pearson lemma, that's the most powerful approach for testing hypotheses. What this lets you do is ask the separate question is, are my effect sizes big enough to be useful and to be predictive of new data? And that's what this evaluates. You might then ask the question, what's the relationship between this kind of analysis and Bayesian model comparison? Are they just completely separate things? And the good news is that there is a formal relationship between those two questions. Which model best explains the data, and are the effect sizes large enough to be useful? I'm not going to go through the derivation and the equations, but the bottom line, and you can follow these references to read more, the bottom line is that the log evidence is equivalent to leave n out cross-validation averaged over all values of n. So that means if you select between models and choose the one with the highest log evidence in your Bayesian model comparison, you are naturally, automatically choosing the model that's going to have the best predictive validity. So that's it. That's the seven steps to DCM success. And potentially, you never know, the seven steps to a Nobel Prize. And with that, I will thank you very much. I will leave some tutorial papers here. I'll thank my colleagues, in particular, Carl Friston, who invented many of the techniques that you're seeing today. And I will leave you with a quote from Richard Feynman, who said, "What I cannot create, I do not understand," which really sums up the whole philosophy of this approach. Thank you very much.